So welcome to day 5 of this training course on artificial intelligence and machine learning. Now this is the first lecture of day 5, and in this particular lecture I'll be discussing about the clustering methodology. In fact, yesterday I have discussed about the artificial neural network, and while talking about the different types of training procedures, I have mentioned that there are two different types of learning in general. In fact, there are other types of learning as well, but in general, the learning mechanism can be divided into two different categories. One is known as the supervised kind of learning, in which case you have a supervisor. That means the machine learning system will be having the set of input and the corresponding output pattern for the purpose of training. So in other words, we can say that the machine learning system is accompanied with a teacher, with a supervisor. Now, in case of unsupervised algorithm, as we have discussed very briefly, the notion of unsupervised algorithm, that there is no explicit teacher. That means the input-output pattern is not known to the system. The only thing which is presented to the system is the set of data points, but we don't know what about the corresponding output for each of these data points. So to solve such a problem of unsupervised classification or unsupervised learning, clustering is considered to be one of the most important methodology to solve it out. Now let us try to understand the concept of clustering. Considering that data point is one dimensional. So let me draw the dimension first. Suppose this is the dimension, and we have, or I think it would be better if I just change the color. Suppose this is the dimension I'm talking about. And on this particular dimension, we have, for example, say we have several data points. Suppose these are the data points. Which are present. Then you have few data points over here. And suppose few other data points over here. So they can correspond to anything. Suppose if these data points correspond to the mass of any person, so accordingly, we can categorize them into three different clusters, for example. One is the set of people who are underweight. Second one could be the set of people who are overweight. And the third one could be the set of people whose weight is perfect. So this dimension can be anything, or the corresponding data point can be anything. Let us assume that we are considering a single dimensional data point. And for example, suppose we have 12 such data points for the purpose of illustration. So just by observing, one can easily identify that, okay, there are 12 data points arranged in such manner, and we can easily identify them to belong to three different classes. Suppose these four data points will belong to a single class, these four data points will belong to another class, and these four data points will belong to another class. So the number might be different. So for the purpose of illustration, I have used like all four. It might be 7, it might be 9, it might be 5, depending upon the number of available data points that you have. And in order to have a very perfect type of clustering or errorless kind of clustering, you should have the number of data points as high as possible. Now, as a human being, just by observing those data points, we can clearly understand how many classes are there or how many clusters are there. But if I want to train the machine in that particular fashion using an unsupervised algorithm, so that machine on its own will be able to identify how many clusters are there and which data points belong to which cluster, then this becomes the problem of clustering. Now, to start with, first of all, we need to provide some information to the machine regarding the number of clusters in which I would like to classify all the data points. So this has to be provided, and accordingly, the machine will take its decision. Now, if I say that the total number of clusters, say I mention that total number of clusters equal to K. So this is the input to the algorithm. So if that particular input is being provided to the machine, then the machine will try to categorize all these data points. Suppose there are n number of data points in the observation, then the machine will try to categorize all these n data points into k clusters. And suppose n1 number of data points are there in cluster number 1, n2 number of data points are there in cluster number 2, and so on. So I can write that summation in ni for I is equal to 1 to k is equal to n. So n is the total number of data points. So capital N is the total number of data points. Total number of data points. So remember that these data points can be one dimensional, as we have shown here, or it can be two dimensional, three dimensional, or any m dimensional. So to start with, I have considered that these data points are single dimensional. So the number of clusters are to be provided to the machine, and accordingly, machine will start its action. So what does it do initially? Initially, if the number of clusters equal to k, then the machine will select k number of distinct data points on this particular axis, and these are known as the initial clusters. Now, for this particular case, let us assume that k equal to 3, then the machine will identify initially 3 distinct data points on this axis. And this is an initial guess. We can consider this to be an initial guess regarding the data points or regarding the clusters. Now, to start with, suppose this point is selected as one of the clusters, which I have marked with blue. And then the machine doesn't have any idea regarding this classification at the very beginning. So as a human being, just by observing the data points, you understand that, okay, these 4 data points belong to one particular cluster, these 4 belong to another cluster, and these 4 belong to another cluster. But initially, machine doesn't have any idea. So it does some random guess, and it randomly selects 3 data points as the cluster, as the initial cluster. Suppose the second one was suppose this is the second cluster, which I marked with green, and perhaps the third one is, let it be this one. So randomly it selects three defined data points as the initial cluster. Then the next step is to find out the distance between the first data point and each of the three initial clusters. So I think it will be better if I write down the steps one by one. It will be easier for you to remember. So the first step is step number one. Select the number of clusters. So that acts like an input to the system. Select the number of clusters. That is key. Second step is randomly select key data points distinct data points and these are known as the initial cluster. So these k data points are termed as initial clusters. Then we are at step three. In step three, we need to measure the distance. Measure the distance between the first data point with the three initial clusters or k number of initial clusters. So in this particular case, we have started with k equal to 3. That means the distance from this point to this blue point, distance from this black dot to this green point, and distance between this black dot to this red. So this distance measurement has to be carried out for all those k initial clusters. So in this case, we have k equal to 3. So that distance measurement has to be done for three clusters. And this has to be repeated for all the remaining data points. That means all the data points which have not been selected as initial clusters, that means which have been marked like a black dot in this particular diagram. So this blue, green, and red, these are the initial clusters, and the black dots, they are the data points which are not selected as clusters. So accordingly, the distance between black to blue, black to green, and black to red has to be carried out for all those data points. So this has to be done. So I can consider next step, that is step number four. So repeat step three for all data points which are not clusters or initial clusters. So that distance measurement has to be done. And then based on that, we need to assign each of the data points to the cluster. That means if the distance between this black to blue is the minimum as compared to the distance between this black to green and this black to red, so distance between the first black to red, first black to blue, this is minimum as apparently seen from this diagram, as compared to the distance between black to green and the black to red. So therefore, we would like to identify this particular black data point to belong to this cluster, which is marked with blue. So the next step says that, step number five, says that assign the data points to the cluster for which the distance is the minimum. Now, under this condition, if I go to the next slide, how does it look like? Let us check, how does it look like? So we have started with 12 data points. Just like this. And then we have selected three clusters, initial clusters, let me repeat it once again. So let me identify the clusters first. So this is blue, this is green, and this one was red. So we have to assign color here for all those black points, and accordingly the clusters will be formed. So as you understand, this belongs to the blue because the distance between this point and the blue cluster is the minimum as compared to the distance between this point and the green and the distance between this point and the red. So this will be regarded as a data point belonging to the first cluster. For the second one, if I assume that this distance is distance between this point and this point is the minimum as compared to the distance between this and this, then obviously this will belong to this cluster. And ultimately, all the other data points must belong to the red clusters, the third cluster, as apparently seen. So ultimately, we do have a situation like this. Although this particular clustering goes against our intuition. Initially, we have thought that it will be something like that. These four will be in one cluster, this four will be another cluster, and these four will be in the third cluster. But depending upon the selection of the initial clusters, the corresponding organization has been different. And after this has been done, we have done up to step number five, we have assigned the data points to the cluster for which the distance is the minimum. Then we go for the next step. So what is the next step? Let me write it over here. Step number six. The next step is calculate the mean of each cluster. After you do that, you calculate the mean. Calculate the mean of each cluster. Mean means finding out the average. Therefore, if I consider the first cluster, the mean will be somewhere here. For the second cluster, the mean will be somewhere here. And for the third cluster, the mean will be somewhere here. So what do you mean by the mean? Mean is nothing but, suppose you have, so in this particular case, we have only two data points, like this one and this one. So how to find out the mean? So mean is nothing but taking the average between these two. So same is true over here and same is true over here. Now, if you have more than two data points, suppose you have 10 such data points, so you can take the average and find out what is the average value or the mean value. So this is the next step in this particular type of clustering, that you have to calculate the mean of each cluster. So this mean has been represented by this straight line, this blue for the first cluster, green for the second cluster, and red for the third cluster. Now, after you do that, after this point, I mean, this step has been taken into account, then once again, you need to find out the distance between each of the data points and the mean. So previously, what you have done, what the algorithm has done, it has calculated the distance between each of the data points and the initial cluster. But now, the step has been modified, that instead of finding out the distance between the data point and the cluster, now the distance measurement is performed between the data point and the mean. So instead of measuring the distance between this point and this point, now the distance measurement will be done between this point and the mean. And this is our step 7. So that distance measurement was done in step number 3. So we can write the repeat step number 3. Repeat step number 3 using the mean value. So you calculate the mean, and accordingly, the distance measurement has to be done. Distance measurement and the cluster formation has to be done using the mean value. So repetition means what? You have to measure the distance you have to measure the distance and cluster it accordingly, a cluster formation. So this has to be done using the mean value. And after doing that, once this process is over, then you need to find out, or you have to check the quality of the clustering. Then the quality of the clustering is assessed by introducing a variable which is known as the variation within the each cluster. So the next step is that assess the quality of the clustering process. Clustering process by adding up the Variation within each cluster. What do you mean by variation? If I consider the first cluster, this is the variation. Suppose this is the extreme minimum point, this is the extreme maximum point. So the mean is located over here, and this is the variation. So the variation can be represented by this horizontal blue line. This is the variation. Now, what happens for the second cluster? For the second cluster, the variation, suppose this is the minimum point, this is the maximum point. So this will be the variation. And for the last one, this is the variation. So you have to find out the quality of the clustering process by adding up the variations within the each cluster. So these are the individual variations. So we can easily add this variation. If we add them, it will be something like that. Suppose this is for the first cluster. Then this is for the second cluster. And then this one is for the last cluster. So the addition will give you this result. So this can be identified by this graph. So this gives you the quality of the clustering process. And if the clustering process is good enough, then the variation can be minimized. So you do it, you do the same process, same thing again and again with different starting points. So initially, it has been done, this clustering mechanism, suppose it has been start with this point, this is the first point, initial point to start with. So if I mark it over here, so initially you have picked these 3 points. This is one point, this is another point, and this was another point. So these are the three starting points to consider the process of clustering. Then the algorithm perhaps have got something like this. The corresponding variation has been shown like this. Now let us do the same thing using a different starting points. So I think it will be better if I just, it's not possible anyway. So let me draw it once again. So initially this clustering process was done using a particular set of data points. And here I'm not changing the data points itself, but I would like to change the setting of the initial cluster. So these are the 4 points to start with. 4 plus 4 plus 4, 12. Now suppose I select the initial clusters like this. So this point is kept as it is, suppose. Next point might be this one. Next point might be this one. And the another point, the third clusters, initial clusters rather. Could could have been, for example, this point or this point, any point I may consider. So accordingly, you have to find out the distance from this to this, from this, from the first black dot to this blue dot, from this first black dot to this green dot, and from the first black dot to the red dot. So it is quite apparent that each of these three black dot will be assigned to this blue, each of these three will be assigned to this green, and each of these three will be assigned to this red, as our intuition says. So accordingly, what we can do is we can mark them blue, green, and red. And this one. The next job is to find out the min. After we assign this one, our next job is to find out the min. So mean can be calculated. Suppose the mean is located over here for the first cluster, and accordingly we can find out the variation as well. This is the variation. For the second one, suppose this is the mean and the corresponding variation is this much. And for the third one, suppose this is the mean and the corresponding variation is this much. So now what we can do is, the next step says that we need to assess the quality of each clustering process by any of the variations within the each cluster. So after we do that, so you have this much, then you have this much, and then you have this much. So this is the result which we get with second setting. Or I can write the variation result is with second setting, or it will be better if I write down the entire thing. What does it signify? Total variations with second setting. So in fact, we have considered this as the first data point, this as the second data point, I mean the initial cluster, and this is the third. So if you compare this one with this particular setting, the result is different. We have selected different data points as initial cluster in exponent number one and exponent number two, and what we have ultimately, the total variation is also different. So this has to be carried out for different initial settings, and we need to do that until the clusters no longer change. So we have to check with different initial settings. So suppose if I just copy this one, this entire thing, I think it will be better if I draw it over here. For the first one, what we have got, it was something like that, the total variations. If I would like to draw it over here, the total variations, it was the total variations with the first setting, as you have already obtained. This is the total variation with the first setting. first setting of cluster, initial cluster. Similarly, we can also have different types of total variation, just like this. Might be like this one. Suppose this is for the first one. Then we do have, suppose if I select the third cluster over here, third cluster point over here, initial cluster, we could end up with a different types of arrangement. Like, for example, if these two points belong to a single cluster, and these three points belong to a single cluster, and the rest seven points belong to another cluster. So in that case, for a different setting, it could have been something like this also. Suppose the first three point in one cluster, then the next three point in another cluster, and then the rest six point in another cluster. So it might be another total variation with a different setting. Total variations, we have added up the variation within a cluster, and total variation with a different setting. So now you need to compare which particular setting is the best. In fact, the machine learning algorithm is not capable enough to identify which one is the best, but at least just by observing the different variation, it can say which one is better. So if I just compare the first with second with the third one or the different setting, so this can be easily understood that the last setting was the worst because it gives the maximum total variation, and the first setting is intermediate in between, and the second setting is the best because it gives rise to the best clustering effect. And this is also satisfying from our intuition because we know that there are 12 such data points arranged in that manner. So our intuition says that, okay, these four will be in one cluster, these four will be another cluster, and these four will be another cluster. So if the machine selects the data points accordingly as initial cluster, then it gets satisfied with our basic intuition. But if not, then the machine can end up with some suboptimal solution. So this process has to be repeated many a times until the clusters no longer change. And in this way, so while discussing the notion of unsupervised learning algorithm yesterday, I have said that there is no such trainer. So no one can guide the machine to select which points as the initial cluster. So machine selects this one by its own, and accordingly, it adapts the parameter. And from that, the clustering output is determined. The next question which must come into our mind is that how to select the value of k. So from our basic intuition, we have initially told that, okay, you select a value of k equal to 3.
Sir, before that, I have... Hello?
And do you have any doubt?
Yeah, before that I have one doubt. First thing is, initially whatever points we have taken, 12, considering all of them as data point, right? So what is the difference between the initial cluster and the data point? These are all okay. Data points only, right?
Okay, okay. I would like to clarify this point.
This is one question, and another is, at the last you told how long we will continue this process unless until the variation does not change, right? So for each cases, the variation will change, right? Like if I take
ओके ओके
any
लेट
point
मी टेक
from
अप
this,
लेट राइट
how
लेट
to
मी टेक अप योर क्वेश्चन
conclude that the variation is not changing?
राइट. तो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी रिप्लाई टू योर फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन दैट व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन द डेटा पॉइंट्स एंड एंड द इनिशियल क्लस्टर्स. सो इनिशियली ऑल द पॉइंट्स ऑफ द डेटा पॉइंट्स टू स्टार्ट विद एज यू हैव मेंशनड ऑल दिस पॉइंट्स आर रिप्रेजेंटेड बाय ब्लैक डॉट्स. सो दे आर बेसिकली द डेटा पॉइंट्स. सो फ्रॉम द डेटा पॉइंट्स इटसेल्फ we have to select the initial guess of each clusters. So they are known as the clusters, initial clusters. Or in some other literature, you can find that they are mentioned like the cluster centers. So they are nothing but a representative of the data points. So there are suppose n number of data points in my database. And I have told the machine learning algorithm to classify them into k number of clusters. Now, to start the process of clustering, the machine will randomly select k different elements from the data points itself, k different data points, I can say, who are regarded as the initial clusters. Or you can say that they are the representative of the clusters. So whenever I make the assignment that okay, which data point to belong to which cluster, so always I will treat that blue point or that green point or that red point as the representative of the blue, green, and red cluster. So initially they are the only member within the cluster. So that initial guess may be wrong also. So to start with, initially all the clusters are empty. So you have n data points, and I have told the system to classify them into k different clusters. So suppose there are k different box. So each of these box initially they are empty. So at least you need to put one member to each of the box, and these members are known as the representative of that particular cluster. So this has been done just by selecting, just by picking a member from the data set itself, right? So this blue, this green, and this red, these are the initial member of those clusters. So that's why they are known as initial clusters. And if you have some confusion regarding the name, you can also consider it to be the initial cluster representative or initial representative of the clusters. So they are the representatives. Now, assuming that this assignment is perfect or this assignment is justified, then the members, the data points which are not selected as the representative, that means those black dots, so out of 12 points we have selected 3 points only, this red, this blue, this green, and this red. So all the other 9 points, they are not selected, but we need to assign them to each of, to any of them, either to blue or to green or to red. How to do that? To achieve this, we have to find out the distance, and then accordingly this black becomes blue, this black becomes green, and these all 4 and 3, 7 blacks will become red. So initial clusters are selected from the data points itself, and ultimately depending upon their position, depending upon their value, all the data points are assigned to them. So this is the first round of exercise that we need to do first, and we have to find out the mean, we have to find out the total variation, and we get some result. Then I don't know whether this process is perfect, whether this process gives me the best result or not. So then the machine will select, since the initial assignment was random, we have randomly selected 3 data points when the k is equal to 3 from all the data points. So it might be that all the data, I mean, this selection was not perfect. So that's why in the next round, in the second round, a different setting is used. It might be so that one of the data points were there previously and 2 data points are new, or 2 data points were used previously and 1 data point is new. as initial clusters. I mean, initial cluster representative, if you want to say like this. Or it might be like that, all the three data points are new. So this is completely random. And the machine performs the same task once again. And it checks whether there is an improvement or not. Now, how to check whether there is an improvement or not? Because since it's a part of unsupervised kind of learning, so machine doesn't have any idea regarding that. So machine needs to develop some performance metric on the basis of which it can identify whether my previous performance was better or this performance is better. So I can give an analogy from our experience, daily life experience. So during the election, what we do, we select a person as our representative. We do it in an assembly or in a parliament or even in corporation, panchayat, we select a person as our representative. And during his or her tenure, say in our case, it is 5 years. And in college and university, we know it is like 1 year. We select some class representative or faculty representative like this. And during the tenure of 1 year or 5 years, we have to check what is the performance we receive from them. Now, if the performance is good enough, then we are happy with that. And if the performance is not that good, in the next round of iteration that occurs after 5 years or after 1 year, we change the setting. It might be that some of the persons who had selected last time, they are retained, or we change all of them and make a new kind of assignment. And this process is done repeatedly, many a times, until and unless we are happy with the performance. Now, this happiness is a qualitative term we cannot define. As far as the clustering is concerned, this clustering mechanism is having some quantitative value by means of which it can at least compare. No, this one is better than that one. So for example, if I consider this one, this particular quantitative measurement, initially, it has started with this setting, first setting. So this is the total variation, blue, green, and red. Total variation is this much. It knows that if the total variation is small, that means the clustering is perfectly okay. Even the system does not have any idea about what is the optimum value or what is the value I'm looking for. Only it can compare between value 1, value 2, value 3, and so on. It doesn't know whether if I reach value, say, V equal to V star, then I am done. This is also not known to the system because it's a kind of unsupervised learning. So there is no teacher, there is no trainer. So if there is a trainer who is there, he or she can tell the system, if you have got this one, then you are done. For example, I can give another fruitful instance. In academics, in our examination system, we know that the performance metric is well defined. For example, if somebody gets 100 in any particular examination out of 100, then it is certified that that person is a master. So he or she has done the maximum thing what he or she can do. Because it is not possible for any person to get more than 100 in a 100 marks paper. So it's a kind of supervised type of learning. So our exam system instructs that if you get 100, then you can't go beyond that. You should be happy with that. That is the one thing, the supervised kind of thing. On the other hand, some of you, I know that in this particular meeting, in this particular course, many of you from the postgraduate background, I mean the PG student. You might be having some exposure to research. Now in research or paper publication, you know there is no such limit. You can be regarded as a very good researcher if you publish one paper every year, or if you publish 5 years in a paper, five papers in a year, then you might be treated as a very good researcher, might not be treated as a very good researcher. Sometimes you can also publish 10 papers in a year and you might not be happy. So there is no absolute measurement. It's all about the relative measurement. Sometimes it happens that somebody has got a PhD degree with 10 papers. Or sometimes a person has published 20 papers, but even if he's not awarded the PhD degree, because there is no such benchmark. So all you need to do is that the comparison. Comparison between the different outputs. Even for a single student, if he wants to compare his performance, research performance in several years of his research work, suppose in the first year, he has published one paper. In the second year, he has published 5 papers. The third year, he has published 3 papers. So now you can compare. He can compare, no, my performance was better in the second year because I have published 5 papers. Followed by the performance in the third year and then the first year because I published only 1 paper. But there is no such hard and fast rule. There is no such absolute term by means of which you can compare. So in this way, the algorithm has to add up the parameters and it will repeat until there is no improvement. Now, if it is found that even after say 100 iterations or 200 iterations, the best value of total variation is within this much, then what happens? It will regard that, okay, this is the best performance what I have seen. But it is the machine learning algorithm is not sure whether it can get a better result than this because there is no such guidelines. So this is the best result out of 100. So that can be treated as the best clustering. So one can come up with some new clustering algorithm so that this variation could be even minimized. I hope that I have cleared your doubts. Then the next question is that how to select the value for k. So our intuition says that, okay, for this particular type of data points, let's start with k is equal to 3. But when the problem is even more complicated, suppose we have, say, n number of data points and might be there arranged in n dimensional space. Say 2-dimensional space or 3-dimensional space. That means the data point is not a scalar quantity, rather we have vector quantity associated with each data point. Suppose I would like to classify the human being on the basis of their height, on the basis of their age, weight, blood pressure, and all these things. So there are different parameters. And accordingly, I have to classify. So in that case, it will be very difficult which value to select for k. So we are not in a position to identify. So the solution is you try the different value for k. So if you select k is equal to 1, it carries no significance because k is equal to 1 means you are making only one cluster and all the points are belonging to that cluster. So k is equal to 1 doesn't have any sense. So at least you have to start with k is equal to 2. That means at least you should have 2 different clusters so that you can classify each of them. Then you go for k is equal to 3, k is equal to 4, k is equal to 5, and so on. And once again, the same performance metric has to be used for the purpose of comparison. Now, before going into the detailed discussion on selecting the value of k, let me tell you very briefly what would happen if I have a two-dimensional data point to deal with? For example, let me consider now the data points are arranged in a two-dimensional space like this. So suppose these two variables are represented like x1 and x2, and these are the data points which I'm talking about. So apparently it seems that you should have three clusters over here. But how to find it out? Or how to apply the process of clustering? The same process you have to invoke over here as well. You select three data points. If k is equal to three, if you select three data points from the initial clusters, from the initial data points, suppose this is the first cluster, this is the second one, this is the third one. Or might be this is the second one, this is the third one. And accordingly, you measure the distance from each of the data points. Now, here the distance measurement will be done in accordance to this formula. So, here, since we have data points in 2D space, so here we have to follow this Euclidean distance. Suppose this will be like say xc minus x whole square plus yc minus y whole square. This is the distance from the point from the cluster which is having a coordinate of xc comma yc, and xy is the arbitrary point. Similarly, if you have a three-dimensional data point, so this is for 2D, and if you have a three-dimensional point, data point, then you should have a formula like this to find out the distance component. And accordingly, you need to assign the data point XY to any particular cluster. And once again, the mean has to be calculated. And as you understand, for a 2D data point, the mean will also be two-dimensional. Suppose this is the mean for this data point, this is the mean for this data point, and this is the mean for this data point, a set of data points. Accordingly, the mean will also be having two different coordinates, x comma y, here also x comma y, and here also x comma y. And with respect to that particular mean, now the distance measurement has to be carried out. So initially, the distance measurement was carried out with respect to the initial cluster, the initial representative which we have selected. And then, as the final step of the algorithm, one has to find out the distance between each of the data points and this mean. And accordingly, one needs to find out the variance. And since it's a two-dimensional space, so the variance has to be calculated along the x direction, along the y direction. And then you can combine this entire variation into a single quantity. Or if you wish, you can also observe this variation along the x and variation along the y separately. And ultimately, from some mathematical formula, you can come up with a particular performance metric. So this is done for a two-dimensional space. Now, if you go beyond two dimension, like three dimension, four dimension, even high, then obviously the complexity will be more, but we are using the same concept over here. Now, one thing is very sure that if you add a new cluster, that means if you increase the number of clusters from, say, 5 to 6 or 6 to 7, as we introduce a new cluster into the system, the total variations within the each cluster will be smaller than before. That is quite obvious. So while making this comparison that, okay, which one is better, then you keep the value of k fixed. For example, while comparing the total variation, here we have selected that, okay, k equal to 3. So k was constant, k equal to 3, and for k equal to 3, for different initial setting, let us check which one is better or which one is best out of this. But if you consider that, okay, there is only one cluster, which is the extreme case, for one cluster, you understand the total variation will be this much, from this point to this point. So total variation will be this point to this point. This will be the total variation when k equal to 1. So it doesn't carry any sense. If you make it like k is equal to 2, then these data points will be divided into two clusters. But while making a comparison between the different initial setting, the k value must be kept fixed. That means the k must be either 2 or 3 or 4 or so on. Keeping k is equal to fixed, you can compare the different initial setting. Now this can be shown that the reduction in variation with the value of k can be like this. Suppose this is the value of k, this is the k-axis, and this is this vertical axis stands for reduction in variation. So as you understand, as k increases, the variation will be, as the k value increases, the variation will also be less. That means reduction variation will be more. And when k is the minimum, k is equal to 1, for example, then the reduction is the minimum. That means the variation is the maximum. So one can have a graph like this. Suppose this is a typical graph from which you can see that beyond this point, there is a huge reduction in variation. From this point to this point, there is a huge reduction. But from this point to this point, the corresponding reduction is not that much. So one can select that, or rather, I can also pick up this point. So beyond this point, beyond this value of k, the reduction in variation is not at all significant. It's almost marginal. But if I go beyond that, I mean, if I select a value of k less than that, suppose this value of k is equal to k star, for example. Suppose this is k star. This is k star. If I select any value of k which is higher than k star, we are not getting advantages in terms of the reduction in variation. However, huge reduction is observed over here beyond this value. So we can write that for any value of k less than k star, huge reduction in variation is observed. Total variation, I should write. However, आफ्टर के स्टार द वेरिएशन does not fall quickly. Or in other words, I can say that reduction in variation does not increase quickly beyond a certain value of k, that is known as k star. So beyond this k star, the reduction in variation is not that much. Or in other words, I can say that the variation does not fall quickly beyond this value. But if I select any value of k less than k star, then huge reduction in variation. Huge reduction we can obtain over here. So one can say that I think there is a mistake in terms of the statement. So we are in the vertical axis, we are representing the reduction in the variation. So for any value of k less than k star, so it will be less reduction in total variation, not huge. Because the vertical axis shows the reduction in variation. So for any value of k less than k star, it will be less reduction in total variation. Or in other words, I can say that this can be regarded as this position, this part of the graph can be regarded as huge total variation. What I mean to say, huge total variation in this portion of the graph. The total variation is huge over here. Total variation is huge over here, so that's why reduction variation is small. So for any value of k less than k star, we have less reduction in total variation or huge total variation, and which is not at all desirable as far as the property of clustering is concerned. And this point of K is known as elbow point. And for the clustering process, one can select this value of K for the better performance of this clustering algorithm. Because if I select any value of k less than this k star, then the performance will degrade significantly because the total variation is pretty large, and which is not at all desirable as far as the property of clustering is concerned. And if I select any value of k higher than this k star, then no such significant improvement is obtained in terms of the reduction in variation. And unnecessarily, we are segregating the points into more number of clusters. This is not at all needed. So under this condition, this k star can be regarded as the optimum value of k, which can be used for the purpose of this clustering. With this, the discussion on, okay, before I conclude this discussion.
Sir, I have one
Okay, what's the question?
question, sir. Sir, can you comment about the can I can we comment about the time complexity analysis of this type of algorithm?
Yeah, sure. When you increase stock, okay, let me take up your question. As far as the time complexity is concerned, I will request you to kindly mute yourself. Okay. So, as far as the time complexity is concerned, so the time complexity of this type of algorithms is dependent on several parameters, first of all. So, let me write it down. The parameters on the basis of which the time complexity can be evaluated. First of all, the total number of data points with which we train the system. So the time complexity, let me write it down over here only. So time complexity depends upon several factors. First of all, the number of data points. So obviously, if you incorporate more number of data points into your training phase, then it will take more time. But at the same time, you must remember that for offline type of calculation, when you do it offline, this clustering process, then if you have more number of data points, that means you are exposing the system, you are exposing the machine learning system to as much data points as possible in the literature. And as a matter of fact, the system is trained at per hour requirement as much as possible. But however, as you increase the number of data points, the time complexity will be higher. But if we do it on offline, so in that case, time complexity will not have any severe implication. But the time complexity must depend upon the number of data points. Then the second parameter on the basis of which this time complexity depends is the dimension. Because as you increase the dimension of data points. Because as you increase the dimension, if it is in one dimensional space, then the distance can be measured easily. The only difference, that's all. If you do it in two dimension, then this particular type of distance measurement has to be used, the Euclidean distance between two points. And as you increase the dimension from 2 to 3 or 3 to 4, the corresponding calculation will be much more. And as a matter of fact, the time complexity will also be large. And moreover, if the dimension is increased from 2 to 3 or 3 to 4, you have to find out the mean, and that mean has to be calculated in two dimension, the x coordinate and y coordinate. For two dimension, for three dimensional space, we have x coordinate, y coordinate, and z coordinate for each of the means. If I have a single dimensional data like this, the mean is single dimension, that is one d data for the mean. Same is true for the variance. However, as you increase the dimension from 1 to 2 or 2 to 3, it is found that the corresponding mean calculation and the variance calculation. So here, if I have a two-dimensional data, then the variance has to be calculated in both of these two dimensions. So the corresponding time complexity or the number of computation is large. And moreover, it is having the implication on the number of clusters. As you incorporate more number of clusters, so initially you need to identify those initial clusters, and the distance measurement has to be carried out between each data point, which are not initially regarded as clusters, or initial clusters, or initial representative of the clusters, and the initial cluster. So if I have 5 number of clusters, so for each element, for each XY, or from each data point, we need to find out, say, 5 such calculation. And if I increase the number of such data points from 5 to 7 or 7 to 9, so for each point, the calculation will be large. I mean, more number of calculations has to be performed. So the time complexity of the system of this particular clustering algorithm depends upon this type of these defined parameters, the data points, the dimension, and the number of clusters. And before I conclude, let me tell you the name which I have mentioned perhaps for the commencement of the lecture, but it should be my responsibility to mention it over here. To make it complete, perhaps you know, but still, this is known as k-means clustering. And before I conclude, let me tell you another thing, that the traditional k-means clustering, which I have discussed in this particular lecture, has been modified significantly. And the AI researchers, they have introduced the concept of fuzzy logic. I don't know whether you know it or not, the fuzzy logic or fuzzy theory, but this is an important area of recent AI development. And the fuzzy logic has been used tremendously. And the concept of fuzzy logic has also been used in this process of clustering. And the corresponding algorithm is known as fuzzy k-means algorithm or fuzzy c-means clustering algorithm, or FCM. In short, what we say, fuzzy c-means clustering algorithm. So these are the different developments which have been there over the last few years in the area of AI and machine learning. So with this, I would like to conclude this discussion on k-means clustering.